We're going to get started. I think it's past time, so. Did everybody get a handout, a picture of the encampment? Why don't we all stand and go to the Lord in prayer, and then we'll begin our study. Okay. Precious Father, we're just so honored to come here tonight as your people to study this portion of your word. And Lord, we just pray for your Holy Spirit, the promise, Lord, that you will teach us. Lord, we just tap into that. And we pray, teach us new things, Lord. We know, God, your word never grows old. And Lord, we just open up our hearts and pray that you'll speak to us in a fresh new way through your word as we read it, as we meditate upon it, as we allow your Holy Spirit to enlighten it, to enrich our lives. Thank you for each one here. Thank you for this body, Lord. Help us to grow together as we search out these truths and to go out into the world better equipped to represent Jesus and to, Lord, to bring a light into the world that's ever increasingly darker. This is our opportunity. Father, may the darkness not overwhelm us. May it not discourage us, but just help us to know in the darkness, the light just glows all the brighter. So help us, Lord, to be a people that are aglow with hope, aglow with love, aglow with the spirit of an almighty God who has given us everything we need to walk in victory in this life. In Jesus' beautiful, precious, glorious name, I ask it all. Amen. Amen. We are going to look at the encampment tonight. The last time we gathered, I taught on the tabernacle. And I'd like to just follow up with the encampment. And the encampment is how the children of Israel, before they started their wilderness journey, were instructed to come into an orderly arrangement. And before we look at these scriptures in Numbers, in the Old Testament, I'd like for us to begin this study with a New Testament scripture. And you might want to turn there, 1 Corinthians 10 and verse 11, to give us some, I really want to get this point across. As we look at this Old Testament scripture, there, you know, it is relevant. It is so relevant to our lives today. Because 1 Corinthians 10 and 11 says, "Now all these things happened to them as examples, and they were written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the ages have come." Now, if you'll go back in that chapter there in 1 Corinthians, you'll see that this scripture is speaking specifically about the children of Israel in their wilderness wanderings. And they're written for our admonition. What does that mean? That means these things are preserved for our teaching, for our instruction, because guess what? We're these people upon the whom the ends of the ages have come. That's referring to this period after Christ has come. And other places in the Bible, it speaks of the Old Testament, not just the wanderings of the children of Israel, but the Old Testament as a whole as being a schoolmaster for us. So that is why the Old Testament is relevant to our lives today. These things have been preserved that we might study them and apply them to our lives. So as we go through this study tonight, I would like to invite you, myself, all of us, to listen to the Holy Spirit and to say, "Lord, what can I learn from this?" And that's really how we should approach all things in the Bible, isn't it? With an open heart, not just read, but have that open heart to hear what the Spirit would say to teach us. So as we look at these scriptures in Numbers, we are, as I said, studying about how the children of Israel were instructed to camp around the tabernacle, and you'll see why it's important. So as we just go ahead and turn to Numbers, and please try to follow along with me because I'm going to go through Numbers. And, you know, if I had plenty of time, we would just actually read these scriptures because it's really kind of like in a narrative form, and it would be fun just to read it. But we don't have time for that, so I'll try to summarize and to bring out some of the major points that I feel like need to be made. So when we pick up there in Numbers, it's where God is giving Moses instructions at Mount Sinai about this orderly arrangement of the children of Israel before they began that wilderness journey. Now remember what has happened. The children of Israel had been delivered from their Egyptian bondage, haven't they? And it took them about 3 months to get to Mount Sinai from Egypt. And then after they got there, God gave them the Ten Commandments. And then God gave Moses instruction on building the tabernacle. And it took about 9 more months for that tabernacle, which was a portable place where, you remember what the purpose of the tabernacle was? God wanted a place to dwell among his people, to make his presence known, didn't he? So it took them another 9 months to build the tabernacle. And then as we pick up here in Numbers, this is about a month later, and it's actually about 13 months since they've left Egypt. And now God's saying, we're ready to go. We're ready to journey through the wilderness, but things had to, I'm sure that if you've observed it all, and probably if you haven't, you know that God is a God of order. And that's what is happening here. He's getting them into place to march forward toward their Canaan land. So if you'll notice your illustration, and also up here, that God gives these instructions about all the tribes gathering together. And we know there were 12 tribes, and then the tribe of Levi. And God told them to gather all the men of war age. And I think they were like the age of 20 to 50. I believe it was something like that, to gather them together and to count them. And they alone were over 600,000, just the men of war age. So if you would add in the other men, you would add in the women and children, I mean, you easily have 2 million people without any stretch of imagination. So can you imagine that number of people out ready to march through the wilderness? So God is telling them how to not be a mob. They're not going to be a mob. He is getting them in place to move forward. So just go ahead and turn over to Numbers 2 now. And I'm encouraging all of you in your own time to just read this account. So over in Numbers 2, here's the instructions that he gave them. First of all, he told them to gather in families to form their camps with their family. And he told them to each one to have a standard, a flag, a banner, you see. And that was really how they knew how to rally together. They didn't have cell phones. They didn't have all the communication. So imagine 2 million people. They needed a way to know where to rally, didn't they? So God instructed each family, each tribe, to have a banner that they could wave, probably in several places throughout their family. And what some of them might have looked like, and these are according to rabbinical tradition, Judah would have had a flag in the likeness of a lion, Reuben in the likeness of a man, Ephraim an ox, and Dan an eagle. And, you know, so forth and so on. They all had their banner. And as I think about that, if you could picture Jesus, our banner would be Jesus, wouldn't it? We'd be rallying here under the banner of Jesus and saying, this is where we gather together, and this is our banner. So now, okay, what are we learning so far? God is bringing them into their place. In the body of Christ, we need to be in our place. We need to know our purpose, our gift, because why? And I've heard pastors say it, he's not out here right now, but he's told me several times, I see the pillars coming into place and in the church. And I know what he means by that. He means we can move forward when everything is in place. So that's the picture that we're taking this picture from the Old Testament, and God is saying to us today, we need to be in our place. Because when we get in our place, we can move forward in this body and in the kingdom of God. And I'm convinced that God is getting his whole body in place to move forward. I'm telling you, things may look bad, but my spirit tells me that God is about to move us forward. So that is my how I feel about that. So now let's just turn on over to Numbers 9, and we're going to see how God gives them further instruction about how to prepare for this journey. Numbers 9. Okay, Numbers 9, and let's look at 15 through 18. Now, pay attention to this. Everything's up. I've got you up to date on that. Now, on the day that the tabernacle was raised up, the cloud covered the tabernacle. Now, what did that mean? That mean that was God's presence, wasn't it? The tent of the testimony. From evening until morning, it was above the tabernacle like the appearance of fire. So it was a cloud by day, fire by night. So it was always, the cloud covered it by day and the appearance of fire by night. Whenever the cloud was taken up from the tabernacle, after that the children of Israel would journey. And in the place where the cloud settled, there the children of Israel would pitch their tents. At the command of the Lord, the children of Israel would journey, and at the command of the Lord, they would camp. As long as the cloud stayed above the tabernacle, they remained and camped. Then go down to 22. Whether it was 2 days, a month, or a year that the cloud remained above the tabernacle, the children of Israel would remain encamped and not journey. But when it was taken up, they would journey. At the command of the Lord, they remained in camp, and at the command of the Lord, they journeyed. They kept the charge of the Lord at the command of the Lord by the hand of Moses. So think about all this. What was God doing? He was teaching them to be obedient, wasn't he? So they picked up and left when he said to. They stayed as long as he remained encamped there. Now this was important, and I want you to think about this, that they learned to trust God. Remember, there in Egypt, they had been slaves, hadn't they? They had a slave mentality. And God was going to have to train them to be warriors before they could take Canaan land. And that would take some time, and that would take God, them learning to trust God. And we can even see in this example of when God got them, told the 12 spies to go over, and God was ready for them to take Canaan land, that what, 10 of them came back and said, we're like grasshoppers in the sight of these people. We can't do this. So they had a grasshopper mentality, didn't they? But God needed to make them warriors. Now, you know what? I thought about that and I thought, what's God doing for us, through us? And I thought, so many times when we're in the midst of a battle, and yes, the children of Israel were provided for, their needs were met, their wants were not met. But what am I trying? I'm trying to say, why is it we're not praying for strength to overcome instead of God to take the hardships away? Do you see what I'm saying? So I think we need to be sensitive to that. Whether we're praying for others or whether we're praying for our own needs, not necessarily God take this hardship away, but Lord strengthen this person or strengthen me to go through this. Because you know what? The hard things in my life, I've come out better on the other side, haven't you? We don't like that. But when we trust God and down the line we look back, we realize God has strengthened us. When we get rid of that grasshopper, I can't do this, slave mentality, and say, Lord, through you I can do all things. And that will strengthen you when you allow the Lord to work with you to not necessarily take away the hard things, but to help you to become a warrior and to trust in Him as you go through the hard things. So that's one thing that I can see that God was trying to do as He taught the people to be obedient. And you know, as I thought about those people there in that camp, I thought about, I'm a little impatient. When I feel like God wants me to, when I feel like I need to do something, I am not a procrastinator. I err on the other side. I would get up in the middle of the night and do it. So I'm thinking of these people here in this tent. And when the cloud's sitting there, I'm saying, you know, can I go? Can I go? Are we ready now? You know, or are you comfortable? Do you get too comfortable in your situation? And you say, no, not now. You know, you can err on either side, can't you? You can get too comfortable where you're at and not be willing to transition, or you can be ever focused on what's next and not live in the moment. So we need a balance there, I'm sure. But the thing of it is to, and you think, well, you know, I thought, well, God, it'd be mighty nice to have a cloud and a fire. But you know what He said to me? He said, you've got my very spirit in you. Yes. Just listen. Yes. I mean, how much better than a cloud and a fire is that Jesus' spirit in us to instruct us? So my goodness, no excuses, friends. So now just think, too, about this environment, this wilderness environment. It was only sand, it was no grass, there was no water. But as long as the people stayed there under God's protection, He provided everything they needed, didn't He? That we definitely can apply to our lives. If we are under God's provision, under God's protection, that's saying in His will, I expect God's provision and protection when I am being obedient, and He always provides that. But when you step out on your own, when you do things that you know that you just do on your own, you are on your own. You are on your own. And I'm not comfortable there. I need my Father. I want to be where He tells me to be. And it doesn't take me long to get back there when I start going the other way, because I do want to be in my Father's arms. So we know that it took God a whole generation, didn't it? He had to let that generation die out and train a new generation before they got that warrior mentality and were ready to go into the promised land when He said, you know, I've given it to you. And that's what He told the first group, and they could have gone on in. I forget how long they wandered in that wilderness, 40 years, and I think within a year they could have gone on over if they had trusted in Him instead of their own weaknesses. So now we're going to bring in a very interesting story. And it's the story of Balaam and Balak. And some people would call this the story of the talking donkey. But actually, it is an account of a spiritual battle. That's really what it's all about, a spiritual battle. And how does this tie together? The way that Israel camped actually affected the outcome of this battle. And I think we'll see that as we move along here. And we're going to see also how this prophet Balaam goes astray for money and for power. So if you would turn on over to Numbers 22... we'll begin looking at that interesting story. Now, as I said, I'm going to summarize this, but as you start out there in Numbers 22, the children of Israel have moved into the land of Moab, and they've camped out there, and we've already pictured this huge number of people, and you can just imagine what that must have done to the inhabitants of the land when this swarm, you know, this huge number of people would come through their land. And we know God had given them victory after victory after victory, and their reputation preceded them. So here they move into the land of Moab, and the Moabites are scared. And you can understand why they are exceedingly afraid, I believe, the way the word of God speaks of it. They didn't have an army that could defeat Israel. And so we're going to see what they began to do to try to get the advantage over Israel. But an interesting thing to me was that they really weren't any danger of Israelites because God had told them to leave them alone. They wouldn't have fought them. God had instructed them to leave Moab alone. So, but this land of Moab really became a staging area for the children of Israel in their conquest of the promised land. So that's just some, you know, details that I thought were interesting. So the children of Israel are camping there in the land of Moab, and the king at that time is Balak, and he is scared. He is really in dread. And so he comes together with the elders of Midian, and there in 22 and 4, let's look at his comment, the King Balak. Now this company will lick up everything around us as an ox licks up the grass of the field. And Balak the son of Zippor was the king of the Moabites at that time. So he, that term, they said the Israelites are going to lick us up like an ox licking up the grass for lunch. So he was really frightened about the children of Israel being in his territory. So let's see what he does. And that begins in Numbers 22, 5, and 6. And I guess I'll just summarize that also. What he does is he sends for this prophet named Balaam. And Balaam is over in Beor at Pethor, near the land of the Euphrates is where it's at. But it's like 400 miles away. It's 400 miles away from where the Israelites are camped. And so this man and his family have a giant reputation for being diviners, for being able to curse people, till their reputation has traveled that far. So it takes about a month for them to get from Moab to where Balaam is. And what King Balak and the Midianites do, they get a group of influential people together and they get a great diviner's fee and they're going to take it over to Balaam and they're going to entice him to come and to curse this people. Because the thinking was in that day, Balak, like all other warriors during that time, their thought was that that they could bring a curse through the God of that people and be able to defeat them because they believed that the gods determined the outcome of all the battles. So that so if you had the right price, you could buy a curse or a blessing from these diviners, and I believe they were called Barus, that were, you know, these people that could do incantations and curses. So Balaam was one of those, and his whole family was famous for being able to do this thing, to bring curses, especially on people, in order to, you know, have victory, because the God that they would offer these, they would offer sacrifices up to, would determine the outcome. So that was his hope. He could go get Balaam, come back to curse these people, that in the natural there was no way that he could have victory. But if a curse was brought upon them by their God, then he had hopes that he would be able to have victory. So he sent his men, he sent all these men, and he sent this great fee to entice Balaam to come. And let's see, where are we at now? So let's look in Numbers 22 and verse 12. So the men came, they talked to Balaam, and Balaam said, give me a chance to go talk to Yahweh. And Yahweh, of course, is Israel's God. So in 22:12, God did come to Balaam and speak to him. God said to Balaam, you shall not go with them. You shall not curse the people. Why? Because they are blessed. You cannot curse them. They are blessed. He apparently didn't really know God, did he? Because God will not curse his own people. He protects them instead. So then, guess what happens? He gives this report to these princes. They go back. They tell Balak. And Balak, he won't give up. He gets more princes and more money, and he sends this great entourage back to Balaam. Now think about all this time and these miles. Remember, it's like a month in one way and a month back, and then all, you know, but he's determined. So he sends more money and more influential people back to Balaam to entice him to come and curse this people so that he can have victory over the Israelites. So in Numbers 22, let's see what happens here. We'll look at 22:15. Well, that's where they come in. Like I said, I'm trying to just summarize a lot of this. Okay, Numbers 22 and 20 through 21. Okay, so here we go. These men have come to Balaam. They've offered him this great fee. They've, you know, I'm sure he's really being enticed with this great, you know, this the all that they've the work they've gone to try to bring him back to that land. So in 20 it says, and so Balaam asked for the opportunity to go and talk to God again. Remember what God has told him, no, hasn't he? But this time, in verse 20, God came to Balaam at night and said to him, "If the men come to call you, rise and go with them. But only the word which I speak to you, that you shall do." So Balaam rose in the morning, he saddled his donkey, and he went with the princes of Moab. Now, when I was studying this, I noticed two aspects to what God instructed Balaam to do. And first of all, he said, if the men come to call you. Second of all, he said, speak only the words that I tell you to speak. Now, as I pictured this, I thought about here is a Balaam in his tent area, probably, and this great entourage of princes over here in their own tent area. And the way I read this, it says, so Balaam rose in the morning, saddled his donkey, and he went with the princes of Moab. I mean, I could be wrong, but it seems to me like he hopped up and he went. He didn't wait for the specific, you know, as God specified specifically, wait till they come and get you. So I'm saying right away, God is saying, he's not listening to me, and I better make sure he doesn't miss out on the second point, because he didn't get the first one. So we all know the story. Hopefully, if you don't, read this, because this is really an interesting how, as Balaam saddles his donkey, he begins this journey. You remember what happens? His donkey... The donkey sees the angel of the Lord standing in the way, and the donkey three different times does this or that to hurt Balaam. And Balaam is what? He's getting angrier and angrier and angrier at the donkey. And just a while ago when I was looking over my lesson, I thought about that, and I saw for the first time in our lives, when things are going on in our lives, things that are irritating us, and we're getting angry at the thing, is God trying to teach us a lesson? And we're focusing on the thing? We're not hearing what God is saying? Our focus is on the thing that is irritating us. And I said, well, Holy Spirit, wow, thank you for telling me that. Help me to know how to identify the thing as being not the issue. Because our focus gets on the thing, the irritation, and we don't deal with what God is trying to teach us. The donkey becomes our focus, doesn't it? I mean, that's pretty deep there, isn't it? So we become like Balaam. We become the donkey, don't we? We look at it till we look like it. So anyway, so what does Balaam do? He's ready to kill that poor donkey, isn't he? He is ready to kill that poor donkey. And some things in my life, I'd like to just strangle them. and I'd be happy doing it. But God is just using a donkey, and I need to recognize the donkey. Right, Alan? You know what I'm talking about. I've got a donkey in my life. Not Alan either. He's dealing with a donkey too, but I've identified it. It won't move, will it? So I think, you know, the Holy Spirit always gives me lessons when I'm trying to prepare you one. So hopefully, Lord, give me the rest of it. Show me how to overcome. So anyway, here we have, but let's see what happens after Balaam is just, he is outraged at how this donkey has acted, and he's ready to kill it. But let's look at verse 20. Let's look at 22 before Balaam actually goes, as he goes out. Then God's anger was aroused because Balaam went, and the angel of the Lord took his stand in the way as an adversary against him, and he was riding on his donkey and his two servants with him. And then all that transpired about the donkey, the angel of the Lord standing before the donkey, and the donkey herding Balaam and doing this and that until Balaam was ready to kill him. So let's see, 32 through 35, after all that has transpired, and the angel of the Lord said to Balaam, "Why have you struck your donkey these three times?" And he didn't only strike him, he talked to him. Have you read that? That's really amazing. And that shows you, that's another point I think I'm getting right now. Don't bother talking to the donkeys in your life. You know, it's just going to mess you up. So, "Behold, I've come out to stand." So here's what the angel of the Lord said. "Behold, I've come out to stand against you because your way is perverse before me. The donkey saw me, and he turned aside from me these three times. If she had not turned aside from me, surely I would have killed you by now and let her live." And Balaam said to the angel of the Lord, "I have sinned, for I did not know you stood in the way against me. Now therefore, if it displeases you, I will turn back." Then the angel of the Lord said to Balaam, "Go with the men, but only the word that I speak to you, that you shall speak." So Balaam went with the princes of Balak. So that was the point that God wanted to make, wasn't it? You messed up on the first point. Boy, you better get this second part right. This is your warning. So let's be thankful for the donkeys, because I'd rather deal with the donkeys than with God, wouldn't you? So if he needs to use one to get to me, so be it. So now let's see what happens after this. But I guess one more point I'd like to make here is this donkey was more able to see this angel of the Lord than the prophet. That's sad, isn't it? That's sad how that is. But why? Why was that? And I believe it was because the prospect of reward had absolutely blinded Balaam. Whether it be pride or money or power, these things can absolutely blind us to God's will for our lives if we, you know, we're not really careful about that. So now, as Balaam gets on into the land of Moab, what's he sent there to do? He's sent there to curse the people so that the Midianites and the Moabites can have victory over them. So we're going to see, as we look at this, three attempts to curse God's people. And chapter 22:41. Let's see. "So it was the next day that Balak took Balaam and brought him up to the high places of Baal, that from there he might observe the extent of the people." So they were getting in place, preparing to curse, to make sacrifices to Yahweh so that Yahweh would give them, bring a curse on these people, and they would be able to defeat them in battle. So they made three attempts to curse the people, and they did basically the same thing. They would go to the places where they'd worship Baal. They'd raise up altars to Yahweh. They'd make sacrifices to Yahweh. And, you know, the thing of it was they would do these burnt offerings to God. But you know what a burnt offering meant? It meant I'm in covenant with God. That was an outright lie. They were not in covenant with God. They were trying to curse God's people. So in the first attempt, God did meet with Balaam again, and he put a word in his mouth. So let's look at 23 and 8. And I'm just picking out parts of what God gave him. I'm encouraging you again to read it. And here's part of what God gave him. How shall I curse whom God has not cursed? And how shall I denounce whom the Lord has not denounced? So that is part of what he came out of his mouth as he shared the word that the Lord had given to him. But another part that I'd like to bring about this in verse 10, who can count the dust of Jacob or number a fourth of Israel? So that this first vantage point where he was looking over the children of Israel, building these altars, trying to curse them, he could see what? A fourth. He could see a fourth of them. And he couldn't curse them from there. He could only bless them from there. So that was number one place that they tried to curse the people and could not. So how was the king affected? In verse 11, Balak said to Balaam, what have you done to me? I took you to curse my enemies, and look, you have blessed them bountifully. And again, God, there was much more that God said blessing them, but I'm going to leave that up to you, you know, to read that on your own. There was a good, great blessing there in that first attempt to curse the people of Israel. Then in Numbers 23, beginning with 13, we'll see there was a second attempt. So Balak still encourages him, let's try it again. Let's go to a different place. You couldn't do it from there, but we're not giving up. We're going to do this. So he takes him to another place, and let's look at what that might have looked like in verse 13. Then Balak said to Balaam, please come with me to another place from which you may see them, and you shall only see the outer part of them, and you shall not see all of them. Curse them for me from there. So again, Balaam went to a place to attempt to curse the people of Israel, and he couldn't see them all. He could only see the outer part of them. And so again, they built their altars, they made their sacrifices, and then again, the Lord did come and he put a word in Balaam's mouth. Look in verse 16. Then the Lord met Balaam and put a word in his mouth and said, go back to Balak and thus you shall speak. So once more, guess what? The people of God were blessed. In verse 20, part of that blessing, behold, I have received a command to bless. He has blessed, and I cannot reverse it. Again, inviting you to read all the blessing that God put in Balaam's mouth, but specifically, it was once more a great blessing and no, not a curse at all. And then in 23, 25, boy, was Balak upset. Then Balak said to Balaam, neither curse them at all or bless them at all. So Balaam answered and said to Balak, did I not tell you, saying, all that the Lord speaks to me, I must do. So now we're going to look at the third attempt to curse the people. And you'll find that there in Numbers 23 and 27 to 30 and then 24, 1 to 13. And let's see, verse 28 there in Numbers 23 tells us that this time they went to the top of Peor that overlooks the wasteland. Again, they built their altars, they made their sacrifices. But look at 24:2, and let's see. We're going to get this vantage point during this attempted curse. 24:2, and Balaam raised his eyes and he saw Israel camped according to their tribes, and the Spirit of God came upon them. Now, if you will study these numbers of the children of Israel, you will see, you know, God told them specifically, count to the north, south, east, west. He told them exactly how to count. And there were a smaller number there and a larger number there, and it, like equal numbers that would have made the sides of the cross. I mean, study it. Look at it in your Bible. And it could very well have been exactly like that according to the numbers of those tribes. So this is the picture that Balaam gets this time when he goes up and he attempts to curse the people of Israel. So let's see here what happens. He's seeing the entire camp in the form of a cross when they're camped the way that God told them to, in this order, that the instruction that God gave them in divine order. And again, we read, let's look at 24, 3 and 4. Again, God came to him, and he took up his oracle, and he said, "The utterance of Balaam, the son of Beor, the utterance of a man whose eyes are opened, the utterance of him who hears the words of God, who sees the vision of the Almighty, who falls down with eyes wide open." So the Spirit of God came upon Balaam, and he blessed the people once more. And if you read that on your own, you'll see that. And of course, in 24, 10 and 11, Balak is very, very upset. Very upset that once more the people of God have been blessed. Now, Balaam doesn't stop there. He stops trying to curse, and he just seems to have a fourth prophecy that's not even an attempted curse. And in this prophecy, which you'll find in Numbers 24, beginning in 14, he speaks about future judgment on the Moabites because of this, what they're trying to do to Israel. And there's also a prophecy of Jesus in that. So look at chapter 24 and verse 15 through 17. And this is part of that fourth prophecy. I think we'll just read 14. Okay. No, that's the wrong one. Let's look at 24 and 17. This is part of what Balaam said. "I see him, but not now." He's seeing into the future. "I behold him, but not near. A son shall come out of Jacob. A scepter shall rise out of Israel." And who was that? That was Jesus. So he was seeing that this was going to happen. And then he goes on to predict this future judgment on Moab by Israel. "And batter the brow of Moab and destroy all the sons of tumult." So he goes on and on, blessing the people and prophesying. So, of course, guess what? Balak threw a party and celebrated him, didn't he? No, he was very upset. He was very upset and angry, and he ordered Balaam to go home. Let's look at Numbers 24 and 10. "Then Balak's anger was aroused against Balaam, and he struck his hands together. And Balak said to Balaam, 'I've called you to curse my enemies, and look, you have bountifully blessed them these three times. Now therefore, flee to your place. I said I would greatly honor you, but in fact, the Lord has kept you back from honor.'" So he says, this is enough, it's over. And it really looks like it's over, but you know, the story doesn't end there. It just gets all the more interesting, actually, because let's go ahead and look at Numbers 25, 1 through 3, and see what happens and how all this ties together. "Now Israel remained in Acacia Grove, and the people began to commit harlotry with the women of Moab. They invited the people to the sacrifices of their gods, and the people ate and bowed down to their gods. So Israel was joined to Baal of Peor." Now, we'll stop there for now. But here's what happened. The kings of Moab and Midian acted upon some shrewd advice by Balaam. And you'll understand why I'm giving Balaam credit for this, if you can say credit. So they arranged a big feast in the honor of their idols, and they invited the children of Israel to take part in these ceremonies. And many of the Jewish people fell for this, and they took part in these heathen ceremonies. And so what was happening here was Israel's weakness was exposed. And that weakness was the lust of the flesh, sexual immorality. They prostituted with the women of Moab. They had this great feast, invited me in, they came, they worshiped their gods, they just, you know, committed all this sexual immorality. And you know, in our world today, that's one of the greater temptations to pull the people of God out from God's will is this same sexual immorality. Mm-hmm. Well, that's exactly what we're going to bring out in this last point. This is really the well, that's okay. That's where we're going with this. So Balaam, it sounded like he just went home, but he set up a trap. He told Balak what to do. Let's look in Numbers 31 and 16. Look, these women caused the children of Israel, through the counsel of Balaam, to trespass against the Lord in the incident of Peor, and there was a plague among the congregation of the Lord. So I'm going to show you more evidence that Balaam was the one that was responsible for this. He put this word in their ear that God would not bring a curse on his people, but God is a holy people. God is holy, and he will bring judgment on a people that is being sinful with, you know, without repentance. So Balaam knew this, so he gave advice to the Moabites and the Midians. God is not going to curse his people, but you get them to sin, and he'll have to judge them. He'll have to judge them. So he set that trap. And you'll find some references in your Bible to Balaam, and his name is used when the Bible is speaking of apostates, that is, people that betray the people of God for money, for power, for whatever reason, for their hypocritical teachers who will betray God's people for money or power, expose their weakness. He did, but he knew that, you know, God's strength too. You can't curse the people, but if you can draw them into sin, God will ultimately have to judge them. But here are some scriptures you can write down to reinforce that Balaam was behind this. 2 Peter 2:15, they have forsaken the right way and gone astray, following the way of Balaam, the son of Beor, who loved the wages of righteousness. So we can go back and we can just drive a nail in that point that we thought Balaam was being driven for money, wasn't he? He from the very beginning, that was his motive, that was his intent. He was enticed by these riches that were offered to him. Revelation 2:14, but I have a few things against you, because you have there those who hold the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to put a stumbling block before the children of Israel, to eat things sacrificed to idols and commit sexual immorality. So you see Balaam did all that. Judah 11, woe to them, for they have gone in the way of Cain, have run greedily in the error of Balaam for profit, and perished in the rebellion of Korah. So we see that even though God wouldn't allow a curse, that sin did separate them from God's protection. They were no longer under God's banner. They destroyed themselves from within. And this is really where I got, I think, my greatest wow or whatever. Can't you see in America that's exactly where we are? Because God, how many battles has God given us victory in? How much wealth and power has he poured out on this nation? I mean, we are just so, to me, a picture of Israel and how God blessed them. But what are we allowing? We are being destroyed within by our sin. And a righteous, holy God will have to judge that. And we are, I know it's a season of mercy, it's a season of grace, but let me tell you, God will not forever be patient I mean, there comes a time when he knows that their hearts are hardened, they're not listening. He will strive with us as long as there's a tender spirit. But we are so at this point in our nation that we are being destroyed from within because of the sin that has crept in. How can God bless that? How can God bless that? He can't, can he? We've tied his hands with his blessings. No, he won't curse us, but he will absolutely have to allow judgment to come. And I think we're seeing tricklings of that. I'm certain that we are. So this is a warning to us to, you know, that, look, this old story is being repeated, isn't it? And that's why we need to learn from it. So even though Balaam couldn't curse Israel, he suggested that their sin would cause God to judge them. So let's see how that actually takes place. So there was a battle between Israel and the Midianites. And let's see, I think I skipped some stuff there. I do need to read this to you. Let me find it. Because this judgment was severe when God brought it on these people. Numbers 25 and 3. Let's pick up back there. You've got to see this when God finally, you know, had to judge. 25 and 3. So Israel was joined to Baal-peor, and the anger of the Lord was aroused against Israel. And the Lord said to Moses, take all the leaders of the people, hang the offenders before the Lord out in the sun, that the fierce anger of the Lord may turn away from Israel. So Moses said to the judges of Israel, every one of you kill his men who were joined to Baal-peor. And then going down to verse 9, those who died in the plague were 24,000. We're living in the age of grace. Yes, we are. But, as I said, that doesn't mean we can get by with just anything and never face a holy God. So they, but what, did you notice there that the leaders were the ones that were called out? So the our leaders that are taking their leadership so lightly, I mean, their day will come, won't it? Because our leaders are the ones that are, you know, able to help us to turn around more. But anyway, so let's see what happens in Numbers 31 and 3 and 7 and 8. Let me just read that to you. Moses spoke to the people, saying, arm some of yourselves for war. Let them go against the Midianites to take vengeance for the Lord on Midian. They warred against the Midianites, just as the Lord commanded Moses, and they killed all the males. Then he goes on to speak about how different kings were killed. But then it says, Balaam, the son of Beor, was also killed with a sword. So that was surprising, wasn't it? Because it sounded like he went home. But apparently he came back if he went home. And he was actually killed in this battle that he had prophesied in this revenge. And, you know, as I said in the beginning, the Moabites weren't even in danger of Israel if they had just allowed him to camp there. So I guess in ending this, and I will, you know, allow, as if we have time, allows for some comments. Does anybody have the time? Oh, is it? Okay. So I want to just make this final picture about the picture that Balaam saw when he went to the top of the mountain. I think that's what the Lord impressed me on, about what this means to me, is we really need to have more of an eternal perspective on things that are going on in our lives. We do. You know, we tend to get weak and discouraged and this and that and the other when maybe we look at what's going on around us. But, you know, we need to ask the Holy Spirit, Lord, give me an eternal perspective. And we'll see things different. If we are able to get a glimpse of the big picture, you know, it will help us to you know, to be encouraged if we will allow the Holy Spirit to give us the larger picture, the picture of eternity, which is not, it's not that easy to do, but I think it's something that we can strive for. You have. That's for certain.
I can choose whatever I want to do. Just like these people were choosing whatever they want to do. Mm-hmm. This is true. Even today, you can do whatever you want to do.
Mm-hmm.
The only thing is that you don't, there's consequences.
That's right.
And you can't choose the consequences.
Yeah. Like going out from under the clouds, you can do it, but you're on your own. Did anybody else pick up any lessons in there that they want to share briefly? The Bible's really an amazing book, isn't it? Amazing. So alive and so real for today, even these old accounts. It is.
There's nothing new under the sun.
Guess what? God wins.
Yeah.
And we're His children, so we win too. And that really is the bottom line. You know, even as I've studied Revelation, and, it can really be frightening. But let's remember, it's not only the dreadful day of the Lord, it's the great day of the Lord. And the thing of it is actually the revelation of Jesus Christ when He comes to conquer. When He sets up His kingdom here on this earth the way they expected Him to the first time. Yes. So, it's good. It's all good. It's all good.
We'll die and go be with Jesus.
Yeah. Exactly. Yes. But we want to take as many with us as we possibly can, don't we? So it's not this us attitude. It's this, let's be the light. Because guess what? People are drawn to the light. And it's the love of God that leads people to repentance. So we want to be a loving people, don't we? But the whole counsel of God, it's always, you don't pick and choose, but it's the whole counsel of God that we need to offer, and because that truth sets us free. So do we have any other, did you learn anything else in there that, you got any donkeys in your life?
Yeah.
Somebody have a comment? Well, I get one point I made was it seemed that Balaam, God specifically said, if they come to you, you'll read that carefully. If they come to you, you can go with them. But I'm not sure there may be a better answer. But it seemed to me that Balaam just jumped up and he went. You know, he wasn't careful to follow the whole counsel of God. And you know, I've had situations, critical situations in my life. Where the Lord through the Holy Spirit has said, do exactly what I say. So it seems to me that Balaam was careless, that he didn't wait until the men came for him, And thus God knew that he wouldn't be careful about the second part, which was you can only speak what I tell you to speak. So it's like God was giving him that final warning to be careful, to do exactly what I said to do. And, you know, it seems like Balaam was careless with that because he had money on his mind and he was inspired more to do that than to follow God. That's the way I see it. If they come.
They might not even have. You know, and so when he got up, he already made the decision, well, they're going to come and come over to them.
That's. But he went with the princes of Moab, so they were there.
No, they didn't come to him, though. They were to come to his tent.
Yeah.
What Father's talking about. If they come to get you.
Yeah, that's why I took it.
They were, he was to wait in his tent to see if they were going to come. He didn't wait.
Yeah, because you can picture Balaam camping here and the people camping here. And to me, God's instructions meant wait till they get up and come over and ask you one more time. But Balaam, like, jumped up and went. Okay, that's a good way to put it. It is, that is a good way.
What I'm doing is what God said to do, but I'm doing it my way.
Anything else? I don't want to keep you. I know we're over, but I do like to have a little time for people's thoughts to come out. So go back and read all that. Meditate on it. You'll probably get at some other things. It's good. It's good. I think our problem is we talk back, though. I do.
Brandon, I have one more thing, but God said, it says the Lord opened the donkey's mouth.
Mm-hmm. No, I'm saying, like, wasn't it foolish of Balaam to argue with a donkey? And sometimes we have things in our life, you know, that get us caught up in the moment and in the anger, and we're really talking to a donkey, and it makes no sense. I guess that's where my thinking was going. But you know, it's crazy enough that the donkey was talking, but that Balaam talked back to him seemed like even like, oh. Another deeper wow to me. I don't know. That's just the way I took it. That's real. But, you know, to me, I'm seeing Balaam with all his thoughts in his mind about all this money, and is he just blinded by the wealth that he's going to get, the power, you know? I don't know, but anyway, I guess that's it. Brian, you look a little on edge back there.
Look, I just don't want to get hit. I'm not saying I'm a donkey, I'm just saying I don't want to get hit.
Y'all will stand and let's dismiss. Well, Father, we just thank you for this opportunity to study your word. And Father, I just pray that each one of us will take away a lesson. Help us to remember this week, Lord. And we just thank you for your written word. Thank you for Jesus, the word in the flesh. Thank you for your Holy Spirit that brings us understanding. That teaches us, that instructs us, and Father, help us to be patient, to only move when the cloud moves, but Lord, to be quick to move when you pick up and you say it's time to go. Whatever area that is, Lord, whether it's whatever it is, we have decisions to make day by day, and Lord, we want to make them in line with your perfect will, but you're so good. Your mercies indeed endure forever. And Father, you're quick to You're quick to go out and to, Lord, bring us back in when we do err. So thank you for that, Lord. And thank you for the body that helps us in those times and in those seasons, Lord, when we might step out from under the cloud, God, that they're not pointing their fingers, but they're saying, come on back in. There's still room for you. There's room for us all. So we just praise you and we thank you, Lord. And we just pray, God, for hearts like Jesus. We pray for hearts that love as he loved, Lord, that desires no one to perish. Lord, that's our heart. But Father, help us to get beyond ourselves. Lord, how I desire to be in there at that golden altar of incense. Lord, I desire to be where I'm listening for your heart. And I'm saying, Lord, what is it that you desire? I want your heart, Lord, and I want to be about your business. So I pray, Father, that you'll just walk with each one this week. Keep each one safe, Lord. Just bless each one, God, to be a light and to remember this account and to learn from it and to grow in it as we do from all of your word, as it becomes living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. In the beautiful, wonderful power of our Savior, Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen.